Okay, so today, just well, now, can you see me now? Hina, just a minute. You keep yourself on, Hina, can you see PPT and me both?
Yes, sir, both are visible.
Okay, fine. Huh. So, okay, let us go ahead now. And today we are going to discuss that is external and internal criticism. And here, this is a very important part of research because whenever you get any documents, any text, whatever written in that document and text, you should not take it as factual information. Because people they write with their own intention. People write sometimes with their own biasness, and many times the text and the documents that we get may not be really authentic document. There could be some problem. There could be certain issues. And to avoid that, we need to subject these documents and text to criticism. Criticism does not mean that we are just criticizing it. Criticism is a kind of evaluation. When you evaluate that text, that is called criticism. And this criticism, I'll not be using the word evaluation now. I just wanted to make the point clear. Now, the criticism word is we'll be using in my lecture now. And here. There are two types of criticism, that is external and internal. And in a very simple term, Sheikh Ali, the textbook that I have, asked you to use, in that textbook, Sheikh Ali used a very simple definition of this external and internal criticism. And he says that external criticism is like if the letter comes to you, what you will be seeing first thing is that does the letter really belong to you? Is it addressed to you? And who has sent it? So that is external criticism, and internal criticism is when you open the letter and try to understand what the person is trying to communicate to you. Is he sincere or is he trying to trap you? That is called internal criticism. So external criticism is a beginning, and it is relatively simple kind of criticism. But internal criticism is when that text or when that document is subjected to very thorough investigation, then that becomes internal criticism. And what is the need of this criticism? It's a very simple thing. This is already covered, that evolution of the sources. And for that evolution of the sources, we need to do these two kind of criticism. In external criticism, let us go get into the little bit of more detail now. What is the external? What we do in external criticism? We try to understand the authenticity of the text, authenticity of the text, authenticity of the author. Period, place where it was written, etc. It's quite possible that some people might come to you and they just say that this is a text that is related to your research. But it's quite possible that that text might be spurious. It may not be authentic. It might have been written later on just to gain popularity. For example, somebody who has not actually seen Shivaji's period. He writes about Shivaji later on and says that I have worked with Shivaji. So, that authenticity of the text need to be verified, and the period, place where it was written, etc. Because, the contemporary, if the text is written by the contemporary person, then it will become a primary source. If the text is written after the person has gone, take the example of Chhatrapati Shivaji once again. If the person was contemporary of Shivaji, then that will become a primary sources. If the person has written 100 years after Shivaji or many years after Chhatrapati Shivaji, then that will become a secondary source. Similarly, place where it was written. Example, if Chhatrapati Shivaji has stayed in Maharashtra, and the person who has never seen Shivaji but only heard about him, and he has written certain texts from, let us say, Rajasthan. So that means he has only heard it and written it. So the authenticity of the text, or how much the narration in that text can be relayed upon, can be trusted, that comes another question. So we have to understand this thing mainly in the external criticism, whether the text is authentic, who is the author, what period it is written, where it is written. Now, even before we do this, we must try to understand if the topic is if the topic or the text is related to our research. Otherwise, it won't be of any use. For example, again going back to the very simple example of Chhatrapati Shivaji. If you are doing research on Chhatrapati Shivaji and the text talks about the British period, then that is of no use to you, even if the text is authentic. So we have to find out, apart from this thing which I have told earlier, authenticity, period, place. You need to also try to evaluate if the text is really anyway related to your research. Then next thing is that it's quite possible that we may not be an expert in all the languages. For example, the language, the Marathi, even though we speak Marathi now, but the Marathi that was spoken in Ganeshwara spirit in the 13th century is quite different than the Marathi now. So if the text claims that it is a text of 13th century, we need to evaluate if the language of the text really matches that period. And it is quite possible that all of us may not be expert and understand and know the language of that period. In that case, what we need to do? We need to, if you remember history's relation with other subjects, other discipline that we have studied, that lesson is already over. So we need to take the help of the expert, and that is called paleography. Paleography is a language expert. So we need to take the help of the people who are interested in language, and take the help of the people who can understand the writing of that period, because the later also evolves slowly, later also goes on changing. Now as you know, now the letters have become quite standardized, because literacy has spread almost, you know, there are many people who can read and write. But in earlier days, the people who can read and write, their number used to be quite small, and the way people used to write, it has also evolved. Now we have, of course, computer and typewriter. So the letters are being standardized now. Now here onwards, there is a less possibility of changing of letters, alphabets. It may, we just can't predict it, but possibility is much on the lesser side. But during those days, as everybody had a different style, so we need to take an expert help to understand. Well, and now this is the main thing we do in the external criticism. We try to understand the authenticity, period, place. Is it related to our research? Secondly, does the language matches with the period? And we may have to take the help of the expert as well. Now, this spurious document, the documents which are not authentic, there are some people who create the documents with some intention. So why do the people do the documentation or tamper with the documents? You know, there could be different motivation. For example, there could be political motivation, there could be intention to desire to get famous, there could be personal rivalry. Some people may not, you know, have a kind of professional rivalry with somebody else, other researcher, and they may create a spurious document and claim that this is an authentic document I got, and my research is more authentic. I have the last word on the particular period, on particular type. And out of desire to get famous, also some people do that. For example, if somebody has found a letter or old document, they may add their family name and then just boast about that my ancestors have, you know, worked with Shivaji, or my ancestors have worked with Peshwas, or even my ancestors were freedom fighters, even if they may not be. So, you know, they might create this kind of fabricated document. There could be a political motivation. If you have a political rival, you want to defame them, or you want to gain some popularity, try to project yourself as a person of royal family, so that, you know, that will bring you certain political mileage. People respect if you have a royal lineage. So with that intention also, people they do create this kind of document. Now let us go to the internal criticism that is called. Now this is an internal criticism, and external criticism is called lower criticism, because that is just the beginning, and it is an internal criticism which is more complicated, which is more complex, and that is the reason it is called higher criticism, and it is also called hermeneutics. Hermeneutics is generally the word which was used earlier for the interpretation of the religious text. When you try to understand, go deeper into the text and try to understand what author has written, does he had any intention, so on and so forth. So we'll be studying this internal criticism in some more detail. And this internal criticism, is also having two dimensions. One is called affirmative evaluation and one is negative evaluation. Affirmative evaluation means you are just trying to understand, you are trying to interpret, and negative evaluation is something you doubt the intention of the author. You try to understand if that author has written with certain intention. For example, let us go back to the earlier example that I gave about a letter. For example, if you have received a letter and then you have verified that letter has came from the person that you know and letter is addressed to you, so you start reading it. Now, if suppose that letter comes from a relative who never had maintained a good contact with you, but now he is writing and now he is praising you. So, you know, you start doubting the intention of the writer. What is his intention? Does he need something from me? So far, he has been just criticizing me or just ignoring me. And now probably he needs certain help. So, you know, when you start doubting the intention of the author and then subject the author's writing for scrutiny, then that is called negative evaluation. So, you know, these are the two dimensions. Then affirmative evaluation, let us start with affirmative evaluation. Affirmative evaluation is nothing but a simple, it tries to give you a simple insight into the author's mind, what author is trying to tell, and you are trying to interpret the data. So, you know, interpret the information. So for interpretation of the information, you need to have great proficiency of language. For example, just now I told you that if the text belongs to 13th century, 14th century, the kind of language that those people were using is definitely different than the language that we use. The word meaning also goes on changing subsequently over a period of time. So we need to have a great proficiency of the language. For example, if you are doing some certain research on the, let us say, religious, Indian religious system, you need to be familiar with Sanskrit. Otherwise, you will not be able to understand. If your work is entirely based on translation, it's always better to know the have the proficiency of the language in which the sources are available. The next thing that comes in the affirmative evaluation. Remember that this affirmative evaluation is a part of internal criticism. So next thing that comes in the affirmative evaluation is deciphering the hidden meaning. You know, there are certain things which are use a kind of allegory. For example, the word is used a kind of Bharat Mata. Now, Bharat Mata itself is an allegory. There is no lady called Bharat Mata. It is in the imagination. But there are a number of people who had laid down their life for this concept of Bharat Mata. You know, they have fought against the Britishers to gain independence. People are, you know, protecting our borders. So, if you are not familiar with the allegory is nothing but, you know, you are using the physical manifestation, but you want to communicate something else. You have certain meaning. For example, dharma will not forgive you. No, dharma is not a person. Dharma is a concept that Hindus generally believe in, that if you do certain things, you will get, if you do good thing will come back to you. You know, there is a concept of karma. Now, karma is also not a person, but your karma will punish you. If somebody says that your karma will punish you and the person is not familiar with the concept of karma, he will interpret it as that, yo, probably karma is somebody who might be judge or might be police person and he is going to punish you. So, are you understanding this? Allegory is nothing but, you know, the word, the meaning is hidden, and the physically people might be thinking that the person is having a physical manifestation, which is not there, like the concept of Bharat Mata. And the person who is not familiar with this kind of concepts may interpret Bharat Mata as a kind of lady, may interpret karma and dharma as a kind of person who is punishes you, and dharma is a person who regulates you. So this kind of thing. So you need to understand this allegorical references. Secondly, you need to also understand the prahor. There are certain things prahor which also communicates the meaning in a different manner. For example, it was said about Indira Gandhi because, you know, in 1971 the war was fought, and she was considered to be a bit dominating personality. And she did not allow anybody of her minister to talk and question her. That is general belief. I am not taking any political stand. I just want to communicate what does that mean. So it is said about her that Indira Gandhi is the only man in the cabinet. Now, if a person doesn't know that Indira is the name of a lady, what he or she will interpret that this sentence is that probably in that Indira Gandhi's cabinet, Indira Gandhi was the only man, and rest everybody else were women. The entire interpretation will go wrong. So you need to understand the proverb. Only man in the cabinet, Indira Gandhi was only man in the cabinet. What does that mean? That means like a man dominate in the family, like a man take his own decision, doesn't ask the lady of a house, you know, in a patriarchal society, and usually is quite bold and quite daring. She had all that qualities that is generally considered to be masculine, and it's because of that masculinity she is referred as only man in the cabinet. So you need to understand this kind of proverb, and then this is all coming under the affirmative evaluation in the internal criticism. And next thing is that there are certain things which are called literal meaning and actual meaning. For example, we'll be studying classical Marxism later on, but there is a one sentence of Karl Marx. Karl Marx said that the state will wither away. Something wither away means gradually it just gets vanished, it just gets over and it no longer exists. That is called withering away. Now the state machinery, if suppose police system, judicial system, administrative structure, if all that is withering away, if they no longer exist, probably there will be chaotic condition in the country. So what does Karl Marx mean is that he does not really literally mean that state will no longer exist. What does he mean? That if there is an equal distribution of the wealth, probably there will be less crime. And if there is a less crime, we don't need a lot of state machinery. We don't need a lot of policing. For example, in the villages, small villages, everybody knows each other. And we don't really have police station at many places, because the crime rate is much on the lesser side. There are a lot of things like, you know, social pressure that keeps watch on the behavior of the people. So what does Karl Marx mean is that we may not be needing a lot of state machinery to execute, to maintain the peace. If there is an equal distribution of the wealth, there will be automatically peace. The crime happens, the snatching happens, because there is an unequal distribution of wealth. And, you know, next thing is that one word can have a different meaning. For example, bill is put in the parliament. If somebody says that bill is put in the parliament, and somebody, if you go to the shop and after purchasing certain goods, you pay the money and you ask for a bill. Now, bill is the same word, but its meaning is different. For example, bill is put in the parliament means what? It is a rough draft on which the law, there will be discussion in the parliament and it may turn into the law. So that introduction of that draft is called bill. Bill is passed means it has become a law now. But the bill that we get from the shopkeeper is a different bill. So you need to understand this kind of different meaning. Otherwise, you may misinterpret the information. The next thing that comes in the affirmative evaluation is finding out the distortion in the historical text. For example, it is quite possible that, you know, earlier the historical text used to be copied by hand. There was no printing press and all. So it's quite possible that during the printing, during the copying, there could be a distortion, and the person who has copied it might have distorted the text, maybe intentionally sometimes, or maybe unintentionally by mistake sometimes. That is called affirmative evaluation. And now the negative evaluation, as I have told you, negative evaluation starts with doubt. We distrust the author, like the example of the letter I gave. When you receive a letter from a person who has never talked to you or who was not keeping in contact with you, you definitely will start having an doubt about that person. What does he need from you? And so negative evaluation, it starts with doubt, and the main purpose is to eliminate any possibility of error. So here we also try to understand the psychology of the author. If the author has really written with some intention, and does it have a kind of a political motivation? Has he written with some political motivation? It's quite possible that the person might be having bias. We need to understand it. All of us, you know, generally speaking, we carry certain bias. For example, a person belonging to one religion might have a bias against the person belonging to other religion. A person belonging to one caste may be having a bias against another caste. A person belonging to one gender may be having a, you know, bias against the another caste. You know, so that kind of biasness also we need to understand. And for that, we may have to go back. For example, there is something called aggressive feminism. And there are certain aggressive feminists who just go on man bashing. They will just go on criticizing the man and portray the man in a bad light. Is the author having that kind of tendency? Or there could be a man who will be carrying this biasness against women. and they will be just portray the woman in the bad light, you know. So we need to understand if the particular author is having that kind of bias, and to understand that we may have to refer to his earlier writing also, and then we can try to understand how much there is the fact and how much his writing is coming from particular biasness. And what is the bent of mind of an author? It's quite possible that somebody who is having a poetic bent of mind, but the king has given him the job of writing the history, and it is quite possible that he may not be very inclined to write about the administrative details, and it's quite possible that the person might be lazy. He may not be a good observer of certain things, and he may not record certain things. It's quite possible that because of age, a person might be having certain physical deformity. He might be losing his eyesight, and all those kind of factors prevent him from presenting the factual picture, and the things might get distorted. And now in the negative evaluation, there are two things which are very important and about which we'll be going into the little bit of detail. There is a term called error due to good faith, and there is another term called error of accuracy. In the negative evaluation, I hope you have understood this thing. If you are not understanding anything, any repetition is required, you can put your question in the chat box. So once we finish these slides, we can take up question as well. Well, so I'll repeat this slide first, and then we'll go to the next slide, and we'll discuss these two points lastly, which I have made it in the bold. The main purpose of negative evaluation is to eliminate the possibility of error. It starts with the distrust of the author. We try to understand the psychology of the author. We try to understand if the author has written with some intention, and does the author was politically motivated? Does the author have certain bias? What is the author's bent of mind? He might be poet and not inclined to administrative detail. He is having, you know, might be physical disability. And then error due to good faith, we will be using that now. Yes. Now, you know, error done to good faith. For example, Abul Fazl, who was a court historian of Akbar, he writes about Akbar, and he showers high praise on Akbar and projects Akbar as a kind of national hero or the national empire who is trying to unify the whole country. So here, you know, his intention is to praise Akbar has arisen from his vested interest, because he was employed by Akbar. So obviously he will praise everything that Akbar does. And if you read only Abul Fazl's writing, we will get only one sided of Akbar's personality. And this is called error of good faith, because he had a good faith on Akbar. Their interests were tied to each other. You know, Akbar also in fact liked Abul Fazl very much. When Abul Fazl was murdered by the agent of Jahangir, agent of Prince Salim, Akbar was, you know, he refused to come to the court for 3 days, and he was very sad that he lost one of his very trusted friend. Well, nevertheless, so, you know, they had a vested interest. So what Abul Fazl will write about Akbar, you have to scrutiny, and you have to understand that probably he has written because he had some vested interest. Next thing is that in some of the writing that we see, people are afraid of public opinion. For example, take the case of religion. Religion in India, almost all over the world, is a very sensitive issue. And that is the reason people, even if they believe that there is something wrong in the particular religious text or in the particular religious practices, they will not be able to air their opinion, because they will think that this might create a very unfavorable public opinion about me, and they may try to avoid. So you need to understand that it's because of the fear of the public opinion that some people don't write what they really believe in. So this is again error of good faith. This intention is good. He doesn't want to, you know, get into the trouble. We just can't force the people to get into the trouble. But we have to understand that probably this could be the reason that certain things are not coming into the picture. Then there are personal prejudice. For example, Robert Clive, from the Britisher's perspective, he is a person who has significantly contributed to the building of the British Empire in India. But from Indian perspective, he was a kind of imperialist who wanted to expand the British domination. So there could be a prejudices. Some people may praise Clive, and some people may dislike Clive, because we stand at the different places, Britisher and the Indian. it's quite possible that out of vanity, also out of, you know, some people have a very high opinion about their own tradition, about their own religion. So that's all, it leads to sometimes vanity. And they may overpraise their own religion, their own family lineage, and be very critical about the lineage of other. The next thing that is done, error of good faith, is, this is a very important term, that is called patriotic error. Now, what does that mean? For example, very simple example I'll give. If suppose an Indian historian writes the history of Indo-Pakistan, and the Pakistani historian also writes the history of Indo-Pakistan war, it's quite possible that the Indian historian, out of his patriotism, will portray Pakistan as a kind of evil state and portray India as a kind of very noble state, and blame Pakistan for starting the war, and also claim that India has won all the war and Pakistans were badly defeated. Now, if a Pakistani historian writes the history of the same war, it's quite possible that he may do exactly other way around and blame India for being, you know, kind of bully, and blame India for starting the war, and praise the Pakistani army, and we'll write that how the Pakistani army has, you know, paid Indian in the same coin and defeated and successfully defended their territory, so on and so forth. So this is called patriotic error, though the event has taken place, but it is because of the out of this patriotic feeling that your writing will be having certain errors. Now comes the next, that is the error of accuracy. In case of error of accuracy, we ask this probability of error. You know, error of accuracy means the probability of error is more in certain cases. For example, if the author might be sincere, but it's quite possible that the sources from where he is writing history, those sources may not be authentic. Those sources might be giving him wrong information. And we need to, that is the reason in internal criticism, we need to also understand what kind of sources the person has used for writing his history. So, you know, what kind of sources he has used, if he has used the wrong sources, his probability of error, his error of accuracy will be on the greater side. He will be making more mistakes. Next thing, the error of accuracy will occur when the event is too big to be covered. For example, let us say Indian National Movement. So it's a very big event. It's not possible for one person to be present at the different places and get a very authentic information. Let us say the Quit India Movement of 1942, which Gandhi has launched. And, you know, it spread all over the country. But it is very difficult for everybody to get a very authentic information until unless he uses a lot of resources. So if the event is too big to be covered accurately, then the error of accuracy is likely to be on the higher side. Same is the case with, let us say, Russian Revolution. It was a revolution spread. Russia is such a huge country. In what are the area the revolution has spread, where the peasants have supported it, if you want to study that and write an authentic document, authentic history, the challenge is too big, for the simple reason that the area is too big to be covered. All right, and so how to check the error of accuracy? First thing is that you have to see how much the event is. It a big event? If the big event, the error of accuracy is likely to be more. Next thing, you have to evaluate did the author verify the information? In what situation author has made the observation? It's quite possible that author might have, you know, landed into the bad situation and may not be able to observe the things in the right manner. Does the author have a tendency of exaggerating, bluffing, etc.? You need to go back to his earlier writing and try to understand that, you know, if the author is having a tendency to exaggerate, bluff. And next thing is that you need to also try to understand if the author is having certain prejudice. For example, we'll be studying about the imperialistic historian next semester, and there is a person called James Mill, historian, and he was an imperialist. So he writes that the British domination was good for the Indian people. Indian people did not have history, they have no culture, so on and so forth. So, you know, he has a lot of prejudice against the Indian. Same thing with Karl Marx. Karl Marx was also having certain prejudice against the Asian countries. And then he writes that Asian villages are static, which is not the case. And then his prejudice was also that behind every action, there is an economic reason. We'll be studying about Marxism. So, you know, because of these prejudices, people are not able to take the holistic picture of history. So these prejudices also result in making error of accuracy will be more on the other side. Next reason that the error of accuracy occur, it's because of the effect of the predominant thought. You know, in a particular period, on the mind of the masses, there is a domination of the particular thought. For example, in case of knowledge creation, in case of history writing, there was an era of romanticism, and during this period of romanticism, everything was romanticized. Romanticized means something that, you know, that create a kind of romantic feeling. The word romance is not confined to the relation between man and woman as we generally see in the Hindi movies. Romanticism means you are over glorifying. It creates a kind of feeling of euphoria. For example, Chhatrapati Shivaji is often romanticized in the writing. That does not mean that everybody is in love in Shivaji in a way that woman loves man. It is a love of a different kind, but it creates a kind of emotion. The surge of emotion we feel, and when they take the name of Shivaji, people feel very excited, very enthusiastic. You know, so that kind of feeling, if that kind of feeling, that kind of dominating thought is there on the mind of the people, people will get carried away by that kind of thought. And for example, it's very difficult to criticize Chhatrapati Shivaji in Maharashtra. People will get very angry because, you know, that influence of romanticism is there, where Chhatrapati Shivaji, there is a general concept in the human mind, in the mind of the many Maharashtrian people, that Chhatrapati Shivaji can do no wrong. And so this is a romanticism. You are romanticizing the historical character, portraying him as a perfect. And if somebody criticizes it, people will not like it. And out of that fear, people may not think about criticizing Chhatrapati Shivaji. So, you know, you understand the effect of romanticism on the mind of the people. Similarly, there was a prevailing thought, positivism. We'll be studying later on what is positivism. But this was also one of the dominating thought in the knowledge creation, where the people believe that you need to write only those things which can be empirically verified. Now, if you write only those things which can be empirically verified, you are missing out lot many things. Because, there are lot many things in the human mind which you cannot put into the practice. So, are those things not important? Those things are. Emotions are important, but positivism doesn't give any place to emotion. And that is the reason this kind of predominating thought will have an influence and we may miss the whole holistic picture. Marxism was one of the dominating thought, and people believe that Marxism is the end of all. Marxism is the panacea for all. Marxism is the only thought that is important. And they wrote history from the same perspective. But there are a lot of things. For example, Marxism doesn't give any importance to religion. But religion is important. It has, united the people. It has changed their attitude. Religion was definitely one of the important reasons which had made the wars more violent during the medieval period. But Marxism, they generally try to ignore it, and we will not get a very prominent. So we need to understand if any particular thought, any particular prevailing ideas was prevalent during that period. So that is also what we should do in the negative internal criticism. Then next is that, do the author have relevant expertise about the matter? For example, the author might be trying to write about, let us say, agriculture during Peshwa's period, during the, let us say, Sadashiv, during the, you know, Madhura Peshwa's period. But is he familiar with little bit of agriculture? Does he know the difference between hectare and acre? Does he know about the little bit of cropping pattern in Maharashtra? If he is not at all familiar with all that, his writing about agriculture might be having certain flaws. If he is not at all familiar with accountancy, account keeping, his writing about the economic history, there might be kind of error. So the person is need to have a relevant expertise about the matter. And, has a lot of time passing, happening and recording the event. You know, if a lot of time has gone off, the event has taken place much earlier, and the person is writing it many years after the event, the error of accuracy is likely to be on the higher side. And so lastly, we'll sum up now. So external criticism is a kind of elementary scrutiny when we try to understand if the document is related to our research. Is it authentic? Who has written it? And what period does it belong to? And internal criticism is much more detailed investigation, which is having two angles, that is affirmative evaluation and negative evaluation. In the affirmative evaluation, we just try to understand in details what the author has written, and negative evaluation, it starts with a doubt. We try to understand what is the intention, what was the influence on the minds of the author, in what situation he has written, does he have an expertise, how much error of accuracy is there, has he done the patriotic error, has he done the error due to good intention. For example, if he has not written anything about the religious conflict, maybe because of the good intention, but then we don't get a right picture. So this is what I wanted to speak today about, the external and internal criticism. Now, if you have any doubt, you can ask. Can you unmute yourself and speak? Or if you have any doubt, you can put them in the chat box. Oh, okay. Audio problem. आ रही थी रोहन, अभी आवाज नहीं आ रही थी मेरी?
No sir, now it's clear.
अच्छा, लेकिन बीच में
No, at the starting there was problem.
Okay. You did not miss anything, right?
No, sir.
हाँ. Okay. Is there anything you want to ask me? Anybody? Ina, Shraddha. This matter is clear? Yes? Yes or no? Say something. Okay then. So I'm stopping here for today. Tomorrow is Holi. I wish you happy Holi. And when will be the next class? I will let you know. You go through the notes. See, the matter. Just a minute, I'll solve it.